Recently, I did an experiment on a religious Christian person I know. I told her that I'm going to show her a picture of an athlete who's supposed to be running in a forest, and that she has to guess who it is. She accepted, so I sent her this picture, with the head and hands censored for the experimental reason. Notice that the hands shouldn't have anything to do with the identity of the athlete, unless they have a mark or a scar of some sort. Yet the girl didn't wonder why the hands were blocked, and I knew from the beginning that she will dismiss it. That is why I didn't cut the picture short to make it look not deliberately covered. First, she thought it was Jason Statham, which I found hilarious, but kept it going. Second, she thought it was me, which is even more hilarious, because she has seen me before, and I'm nowhere close to this physique, not to mention the skin color. But I assumed that she thought the athlete was wearing a bodysuit. So it went on. She asked if I was an actor, to which I still replied, no. And her last guess was Atlas. But after that, she gave up. And that is when I told her that this is actually an ape. It was only a lie for experimental reasons. She was surprised, but I confirmed it by sending her the full picture. All she said next was, interesting. She knew where the conversation was going, but she tried to pass it off with the hope that it doesn't end up proving something that she doesn't feel prepared to confront. Usually, when a religious individual is confronted with overwhelming information contrary to their beliefs, they resort to presenting irrelevant information or asking what I like to call counter questions to divert the attention to questions they feel more prepared and confident to answer. But that fails when they get told that more questions or irrelevant information still don't answer the initial question. Anyway, the conversation continued, and I told her that I was also astonished to see that an ape's physique or muscular and skeletal structuring is so identical to ours. She kept saying that it's still different, and that she would have known that it's an ape had it been in a different position. But the position of the animal isn't the point. It's the body of the animal itself. Without the head, the hands, or the body hair, she wasn't able to distinguish the creature from a human being at all. Now, just like I don't believe that we all descended from Adam and Eve, for logical, anthropological, and historical reasons, I don't believe that we all descended from a species of apes either. And that's just because I personally don't use belief to reach any conclusion, unless I'm using someone else's way of thought during a process of deduction or induction to know what he or she may be thinking. Theories and beliefs change and evolve, but observable facts remain consistent with their natural law, and they are hard to ignore. That's why we hear of professors who turn Christian, and scientists who convert to Islam, and Christians who turn to atheism. But we don't hear anyone with a sound mind deciding to quit accepting gravity or physics. The theory of evolution may sound ridiculous to the religious communities, but the idea that we may be another kind of ape altogether is considerably possible. The religious may argue that our intelligence is higher than that of other animals, but it's just absurd to compare the average intelligence of one species to another. Any reasonable person wouldn't go around comparing the intelligence of a fish to that of a crocodile. And even between us humans, the general intelligence of each person can vary on a large scale. The fact that we use two limbs to walk also does not work in the favor of a religious argument. As a matter of fact, using our legs to walk has not only allowed us to create tools, but also gives us the right posture for bigger vocal cords and lingual spacing, allowing the invention of various languages. So our intelligence as a species, combined with our skull size and erect posture, is why we speak different languages and create technology that gives us survival advantages and control over other animals. Each of our abilities helped enhance and shape the other over time. But going back to the hairless ape, I will ask every Christian who is watching this video two questions. Out of all the countless designs that God used to create every living being, why create the most important beings, the beings closest to him, who are supposed to resemble his holy image on earth, with the physical build of chimpanzees? And if the spirit of God and the soul are the only things that separate the human from the animal, since they are all made of the earth's dust, doesn't that make it easier to see that the human body is that of just another bipedal primate? The fun behind those questions lies in the point that no one can prove the spiritual part, but everyone with functional eyes can see the physical one. Ha ha ha!